Hey, good news. We're here with our architects, Uli and Eric, to talk about hybrid and multi-cloud architectures. Join us. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we'll be discussing the challenges you and our other tech-savvy customers have encountered. Together, we'll be talking with experts to find out how they think about these problems, recommended tools and best practices, and tips they've learned from years of experience that you can use. So today on the Azure Enablement Show, we're doing something we've never done before. We're going to take our script, and we are going to simply rip it up, because we want to talk today about architecture. And architecture is a discussion. Okay, so we're back with Uli and Eric for another discussion about architecture stuff. This time we're going to talk a little bit about multi-cloud and hybrid cloud stuff. And I have to admit, having been in this field for a long time, I have heard hybrid cloud be used for all sorts of things. Like it looks like, you know, like the word hybrid no longer has a meaning to me because I've heard so many different meanings. I think we need to level set here. Can one of you two folks please tell me what you mean when you mean multi-cloud and what you mean when you say hybrid cloud and how they're different, so we can just level set there first?
Uli, do you want to start, kick this one off? I've got my own thoughts, but I want to see what you have to say first.
Well, the way I think about this is we're talking about multi-environments, not multi-cloud this or hybrid cloud that, because at the end of the day, we need to be able to put compute or solutions where the scenario requires it. And that could be in a car, it could be in a factory, it could be in a data center that you own, it could be in a telco edge environment. I'm sure you've heard about those these days. It could be in the cloud, it could be in the Microsoft cloud, it could be in the Amazon cloud, whatever it might be. And from my perspective, solutions these days need to do two things. One, they need to be able to run, or parts of it need to be able to run where they need, where they are required. It could be in the factory that you need to be there. It could be in the car, or it could be in the back end, let's say a cloud. And then the second thing is you need to be able to take advantage of the environment that you're in an ideal fashion. So if it's a constrained environment, you need to run constrained. But if you have a cloud environment, you should be able to run back end in an ideal fashion, use all of the resources. Unfortunately, I see too many software packages that I would, what I call hostable. What that means from my perspective is they just write the code to a common standard, let's say like Kubernetes or the Cloud Native Compute Foundation environments, and then effectively tell their consumers, this can run anywhere. That's true, but they don't take advantage of anything either. And so part of the question is, how do you balance the need to run where you need to run quick, which means anywhere or in multiple environments. And at the same time, how do you understand what the services are that you are presenting and make sure that the services utilize the environment as optimal as possible?
Yeah, like cloud app design principles are key. Like just porting an on-premises workload into a container environment and saying it's now a cloud app is not necessarily the best way to go. It's oftentimes just a milestone to get to that, you know, cloud app design pattern. But I think what's interesting is these terms hybrid cloud and multi-cloud. Like when I say hybrid cloud, in recent history, we all knew what that meant. That meant some data center that I can actually walk into and badge into, talks to, and has an application that spans a connection to the cloud for something. And the thing that I'm asking myself nowadays, and understanding all of the scenarios that Uli went through with like partially connected devices, I have, you know, things on the edge, does hybrid cloud and multi-cloud kind of all represent an environment where the app is two places? Some component of it is either in, you know, one cloud provider and another cloud provider, or one cloud provider and on-premises, or all three of those things. So I think that the differentiation between hybrid cloud and multi-cloud is actually kind of just blurring a little bit these days.
Yeah, I mean, the piece I would add, Eric, both of us have kind of described a static world where you make a decision once it runs in the factory or in the car or in the on-premise data center and another parts runs in a cloud, doesn't change. Well, that's actually not true anymore. We're starting to see desires where people say, well, during the day, I want my application, the user interface, let's say, run optimized in telco clouds because they are closer to my end user and the latency is low and so forth. But during the night, I want to retract all of those services and provide a user interface for the cloud for the night owls, let's say. But they're far fewer, and a little bit of increase of latency doesn't hurt. So don't just think about this as a static thing. Also, you will be able to dynamically optimize. I call that vertical scaling rather than horizontal scaling. And it's certainly a new pattern that I think we will get more providence with 5G and other things becoming ubiquitous.
Where it becomes possible to actually throw stuff between it and not have people actually know the difference. I mean, because once upon a time, like multi-cloud used to be cloud plus one, right? Like I want to make sure that if for some reason my cloud provider is not nice to me or they go down or whatever, I can go somewhere else. And it sounds like you're discussing a pattern that is actually more steady state and not just like disaster recovery. It's more like, yeah, I'm intentionally doing it this way because I can go there.
Can I address that? I think my cloud provider's not nice to me is a great way to encapsulate a very real concern that a lot of our customers still have to this very day, which is, I don't want to be beholden to one provider, because if they are not nice to me on one extreme, or they go down, what am I left with? Or they retire a component or a service that I depend on, what do I do then? I can't tell my customers, hang on while I rewrite and redeploy to another cloud. So those are very real concerns. And I think real discussions with cloud providers is something that's all very important. But doing it just because you don't want to have all your eggs in one basket is not really the wise, in my experience, is not really the wisest decision. Because then you have total cost of ownership and integration challenges and the construction or the creation of technical debt, which might span your effort just not to get hurt by one cloud provider. And so that in itself could be harmful.
But again, Eric, let's be generous with our clients, because if you're, for example, in a regulated industry, you might have to be able to extract yourself from what the regulator calls a systemic dependency. And the cloud would be a systemic dependency. So for me, there are very valid reasons outside of risk management that really require us to think through how we can help our clients to, on the one side, write software that's flexible in terms of it can run in multiple environments, but on the other side, also take advantage of the innovation that each cloud provider, including Microsoft, is providing, because you can't expect everything to be available everywhere at the same time. And so I think there's a balance to be had. And architecture, our topic, is the way to balance this. From my perspective, if I were designing a new application, let's start with a fresh one, what I would do is I would look at my architecture. We talked about application patterns before and thinking through how you separate certain pieces. The core of the application, most likely I would write in a way that would allow me to extract myself from a dependency. But there are other things where I would love to be able to utilize the innovation that either AWS or Microsoft or Google provides. And so I isolate that architecture, again, using the bulkhead pattern we talked about before, to effectively enable me to innovate in this area, utilize the latest and greatest, but be able to, or consciously decide that I might have to rewrite that part of the application for another cloud environment. And so for me, it's not black and white, it's much more gray. And I think a lot of architects would do well thinking through where am I okay to rewrite this because I'm getting benefits from going proprietary in a specific environment? And where do I benefit from staying with, for example, a Kubernetes basis or something like that?
Okay, so I have one last question here. When you go multi-cloud or even hybrid cloud, there's this operational context, right? Where if something does go wrong, and I'm thinking about this from the customer perspective, if something does go wrong, or if you have to pay attention to privacy, or you have a regulated situation or stuff like that, it means that the people that are operating the thing, and I count myself as in that group from my background, will have to interact with cloud provider X. And tomorrow they might have to, they might have 2X if they have 2 clouds that they have to do it. So as architects, is there anything we can do to to improve or make that operational context not nearly 2x, so it's not scaling linearly with clouds?
Yeah, the way I think about this, David, is there are three elements that you need to think about when you think about operations. The first one is there is a static setup. It's not static over a long period of time, but for weeks or months, it might be static. We call those landing zones or control towers, those kind of things, where you effectively set up the infrastructure of cloud provider A and cloud provider B in a way that protects your enterprise and so forth. That I would always use proprietary capabilities for, because you want it optimal, you want it scalable, you want it cost efficient. Then the second piece is you want to have the daily tasks, like getting the monitoring information, getting the login information, being able to look at what's happening across my entire environment. That's why I call it multi-environments, in a single pane of glass. Those you want to be able to utilize a single environment in an ideal case that brings all the data into it. The third and final thing is when stuff really gets very bad. So I talked about the static setup of the infrastructure and the daily monitoring, the daily logging management and those kind of things. When stuff doesn't work anymore, then you will have to most likely revert to cloud native tools or environment native tools, to use the language I've been using all the time, because you now need to want to go deep into the troubleshooting stack. There again are common tools that allow you to do certain things. But in that case, if you are using multiple environments, let's say multiple clouds, you will have to build experience and people up that understand cloud A, cloud B, cloud C, because ultimately it goes into the bowels of the beast. And therefore, it is going to be special, very focused on the environment that you are in. So
yeah,
if you organize yourself around these three, I think you can come to a very healthy balance.
I think balance is, especially when it comes to operation, is key. I've had customers that really underestimated the amount of orchestration and preparation needed to manage multiple clouds. Everything from live site operations to deployment of components to monitoring, it takes on a new dimension of complexity across multiple clouds. Even just trying to figure out maybe whose fault it is, who's down, becomes a challenge.
Well, as much as that's like a cliffhanger, I think this is probably a really good place to stop. Thank you very much. And I hope you'll join me on another one of these discussions, because I know we got a bunch of things to talk about.
I'll be back.
Yep.
Okay, well, we're deep in the middle of this conversation. I really hope you'll join us on the next episode where we pick up right where we left off. Join us again on the Azure Enablement Show.